Aloha and welcome to PTC21. My name is Tony Mosley. I work for Ocean Specialists, Inc. And today I have the great pleasure of introducing session three in the Submarine Cable Workshop, moderated by my friend Elaine Stafford of DRG, who most of you know from her many years of service to the subsea community. Over the past year, Elaine, Paul McCann, and I have been meeting weekly along with the team from PTC to develop these sessions. Little did we know when we started that it would be virtual and that we would not be running down the corridors of the Hilton in beautiful Hawaii to make it to the ballroom on time for this session. A big thank you to all of our panelists and contributors in the subsea community that have volunteered your time and energy to make these sessions a success. I'd like to thank Paul and Elaine for this fantastic journey and also thank our sponsors, Suboptic, and all of the sponsors who have been invaluable. This session will cover one of our industry's most difficult, expensive, controversial, and challenging items today, geopolitics and its impacts on the way we conduct our business. Speaking of impacts, I would be remiss if I didn't say a word about COVID-19 and how it has changed the many aspects of not only the subsea community, but all of our communities. We've had to adapt our thinking, planning, and certainly travel to continue to develop submarine cable projects. But we are fortunate in the subsea community that it's mission-driven, supported by brave men and women that go to sea, work in factories, and build these facilities that help keep us moving forward. Our collective hats should be off to all of those men and women that risk not only a toll that the sea can take, but also doing this work during times of pandemic. Thank you. The work that you do is amazing in this industry, and 99.8% of the transoceanic global internet continues to function during these unprecedented times because of you. Again, thank you to our sponsor, Suboptic, the hardworking team at PTC, and all of you out there that have contributed your time during this tough time of a pandemic. Elaine, Paul, it has been an honor. Enjoy the session. Please engage those posters. There's some very thoughtful and innovative discussion and hope to see all of you live next year. With that, I'll turn it over to you, Elaine. Thank you.
Thank you, Tony. I wish I was as thoughtful in my opening comments as you. You have some wonderful and worthwhile words to share with all of us. Hello to all of our listeners across the globe. Today we're talking about, as Tony said, the impact of geopolitics on our industry. I'd like to reiterate Tony's thanks to PTC and all of their organizing team who have been so helpful, to our panelists who I'm sure you'll be intrigued by soon, and also, as Tony did, to Suboptic, our sponsor of today's workshop. A little commercial advertisement, please do take time to visit Suboptic's hospitality suite on the PTC site. Suboptic has some exciting announcements about their 2022 conference, plus announcements regarding several new initiatives designed to benefit the industry as a whole, including the establishment of a not-for-profit foundation whose initial focus will be on the important research, education, and outreach projects. Back to today. I've been moderating these panels for many years now, and when I was recently speaking with one of today's panelists, he jokingly asked me what unique surprise I had planned in my introductory remarks. So let me apologize in advance. Today, I have no pictures of panelists in their Speedos, nor do I have caricatures of them as Star Wars figures, as I have in the past. Instead, my personal message today is the very simple message, same very simple message that I shared at last year's PTC. Today is about furthering our industry's mission and responsibility to connect the world. I'm hopeful that today's discussion provides each of you with worthwhile and stimulating ideas that help all of us steer around the many challenges we are facing today. For many of our businesses, the impact of government and politics on our community can sometimes feel like more of a hindrance than a help, as we all do our best to connect the world. Maybe, just maybe, there will be some ideas that come out of today's discussion which help us find a path forward that meets both industry and government objectives. Towards that end, I'm hopeful that this will be one of our best PTC workshops ever. We have many panelists today who need no introduction whatsoever. I'd ask all of you to turn your cameras on now. They'll recognize your faces and your names. With a mix of lawyers, politicians, and engineers, who could ask for anything more? We've got Kent Bressy, partner at HWG and counsel to ICPC. Andy Littman, senior partner at Morgan, Lewis, and Bacchus. Mike Constable, who brings his decades of varied experience from the system supply, marine services, and network ownership side of the industry. And then we've got Russ Matalich, CEO of the RTI Group, who has built a private undersea Asia Pacific network. And if those gentlemen were not enough to captivate your interest, our guest speaker on the panel deserves an even longer introduction. I'm really thrilled that Mr. Esko Aho, chairman of the board of Sinia Oy, former prime minister of Finland, has made time to join us here today. Esko brings a unique combination of telecommunications, undersea cable, and government policy experience to our panel. His bio is far too long to read now. Suffice it to say that he's highly influential, highly educated, and highly accomplished, and based on my discussions leading up to today, extraordinarily insightful. Many of you know that Sinia already owns the Sea Lion cable connecting Finland to Germany and is now working on a much bigger project. Sinia, with others in Russia and Japan, are working together to construct the Arctic Connect cable, which will connect Europe to Asia on a new, diverse, low-latency route. You can easily imagine that there are innumerable geopolitical and regulatory issues to be managed on this project, and Esko is in a very unique position to facilitate their resolution. Thus, I'm sure Esko will provide us with invaluable food for thought about how to balance national security, political, and economic interests with the need for new international communications infrastructure. Thank you so much, Esko, for joining us today. We're going to start today's session with Kent giving us an overview of the history of geopolitical influence on our industry over the past many decades. From there, Mike Constable is going to share insights on some of today's challenges imposed by the complicated world we live in. Together, these two presentations will provide a valuable backdrop to the panel discussion, which will follow after a very short break. To wrap up my introduction this morning, I'd like to reflect a bit on history myself and give credence that there is light at the end of today's tunnel. Some of us might be tempted to believe that what we're experiencing today with U.S.-China issues and the related U.S.-driven clean network and clean cable policies represent a new form of challenge to our industry. But I think not, and I hope we look beyond that today. Many of you recall that just 10 years ago, there were major political disruptions in the Middle East and new cable projects, which were hugely delayed between the Red Sea and the Mediterranean by government. Alternate routes then, as for decades before, and in the last 10 years, eluded realization, all because of geopolitics. And yet today, there are at least two new projects making real headway in that region that some of us never dreamed would become ever possible. For then insurmountable geopolitical reasons. There's the Google and Omantel Blue Raman project and Centurion's TS cable, each of which have publicly announced plans to create new diverse routes across the Middle East. Thus, I've personally got hopes that today's political challenges, be they in Asia Pacific between the US and China, or in the Caribbean connecting to Cuba, or in the Arctic connecting Europe and Asia, that at some point in time, these two will be behind us. That is what some of us dream can help influence, we can influence in some very small constructive way with the ideas that are exchanged today. Because that's what we do as an industry. We find a way to connect the world despite roadblocks that seemingly get in our way. And that's what all of our panelists are here today to share with us. So with that, I'd like to turn it over to Kent, whom most of you already know, who will talk about the history of geopolitical influence on our industry, both the subsea supply and global network industry. Thank you for joining us today, and thank you, panelists. Kent, it's up to you now.
Great. Thank you so much, Elaine, for that very gracious introduction and helping to frame our workshop discussion today. I'm very pleased to see that so many people could join us electronically since we couldn't get together in person in Honolulu. Here's hoping that that can happen in 2022. So my presentation today is not meant to be a comprehensive history of political issues with submarine cables, but it's meant to illustrate some particular ideas and themes that we're going to draw upon in the rest of the workshop today. And so I think just trying to get my slides working properly. So with that, we'll move into our discussion. I think that, as Elaine indicated in her introduction, political issues with submarine cables are not new. And I think that from the very outset with submarine telegraph cables in the mid-19th century, that has been the case, that submarine cables have been a subject of geopolitics. And why is that? Well, submarine cables are fixed infrastructure that traverses jurisdictional areas of multiple countries and areas now with our modern law of the sea framework under the UN Convention on the Law of the Sea, areas beyond national jurisdiction. And I'll talk a little bit about the negotiation of UNCLOS and what that meant for submarine cables. This sort of cross-border, long-haul international activity requires some level of cooperation and coordination, or at least acquiescence among states. And cables serve very important functions. I think that for a while, again, as I'll mention, in the mid-20th century, there was an assumption that it would be all about satellites. But at the beginning with submarine telegraph cables, there was an enormous excitement about what they represented for global communications. And over time, that importance has only grown in terms of economic, social, and national security issues. And these cables now certainly we're connecting today using submarine cable infrastructure with our audience around the globe. These cables aggregate vast amounts of traffic, and they do so on a relatively discrete number of facilities, which also makes them an issue of great political interest. And so governments variously promote, protect, regulate or control, sometimes neglect, and sometimes target submarine cables. And you might be wondering what this image is here. This is actually part of a fresco in the U.S. Capitol Dome. Our Capitol, sadly, the site of a lot of destructive activity so far in 2021. Thankfully, some of the artwork like this fresco was not damaged, but this fresco by Constantine Brumidi, the apotheosis of Washington, actually shows the original Atlantic cable held by the figures underneath Neptune with his trident. And this indicated the importance at the time when this cable was built in the 1860s, what that meant for the United States and for transatlantic relations. So moving later into the 19th century, submarine telegraph cables at the time were really an activity dominated by the British. The British built submarine telegraph cables to connect the British Empire, the pink bits on the map as they were always represented, Over time, the Americans, the French, the Germans, and the Danes emerged as competitors in those businesses, particularly the Americans and later the French. In many cases, cables were owned by governments or by companies that were controlled by governments or subsidized by them. So it was never a purely private activity. There was always a government role. And there was a recognition early on that submarine cables could become targets. At the 1884 Paris Convention, where the Convention for the Protection of Submarine Telegraph Cables was negotiated, still one of the principal treaties that we point to, particularly within ICPC and working with governments to protect submarine cables from damage. The negotiating parties considered but declined to agree to recognize the neutrality of submarine cables in wartime, tacitly acknowledging that they could become targets because of their national security and economic importance, particularly in times of war. And this was borne out particularly during the Spanish-American War. The United States cut all submarine telegraph cables connecting Cuba to the United States and connecting the Philippines to Hong Kong, Cuba and the Philippines both being Spanish colonies at the time. These considerations did not abate, but became more acute in the run-up to and the time during World War I. There was a lot of cable cutting activity initially by the British with attempts to force the Germans to use British cables so that German messages could be subject to interception. And the Germans retaliated by cutting other cables connecting Britain and other parts of the world. There was also a lot of surveillance activity going on with messages on submarine telegraphs. The British intercepted the famous Zimmermann telegram in which Germany urged Mexico to attack the United States, and the British used that to encourage U.S. entry into World War I. In 1917, President Wilson issued an executive order titled Censorship of Submarine Cables, Telegraph, and Telephone Lines, prohibiting transmission of messages outside the continental United States or near the Mexican border in order to minimize the chances of interception by the Germans. In the era after World War I, the world really moved into an era of reciprocity-based market access. To build a submarine cable on an international route, you had to have a local, often government-owned partner on each end of the cable. And after seeing sort of an early free-for-all with construction of submarine telegraph cables, governments started to regulate cables. In 1921, in the United States, Congress enacted the Cable Landing License Act. This was largely to limit reliance on British telegraph cables, but there was also concern, this was during the Red Scare, concern that unauthorized cable landings could threaten national security and further communist influence in the United States. The United States started developing a policy that existed until 1997, where market access would be permitted in the United States only if a foreign country afforded effective competitive opportunities. It wasn't phrased in that way at the very beginning, but essentially, we'll let your people in if you let ours in for construction of cables. And so this, in some ways, was not problematic because there was already some consortium-based activity with submarine cables. But of course, at the very beginning, these weren't consortia. They were single-owner systems. And we didn't see that again until the late 1990s with the emergence of companies like Global Crossing. During the Cold War, there was an acute focus on surveillance and spying of all sorts, but this also included submarine cables. Most infamously, in the 1970s, the United States tapped what was then, this was the analog era, with coaxial cables. So it was much easier to conduct surveillance. But the United States parked submarines on the seafloor of the Sea of Okhotsk on the Pacific coast, off the Pacific coast of Russia, to tap telephone cables in an initiative known as Operation Ivy Bells. There's a great book written about this called Blind Man's Bluff, written by a couple of journalists from the Wall Street Journal about what this represented. But as spy novelesque as that seemed, was not known at the time, and the public's imagination was really captured by satellites and space. And everybody seemed to think that satellites would be the future of international communications. But both satellite communications and submarine cable communications remain susceptible to unauthorized surveillance, and governments did so vigorously. So in the run-up to 1982, when most of the world's nations signed the United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea, there had been a series of international treaty conferences to develop this convention and really set some ground rules for various activities in the oceans, and establishing jurisdictional rules, establishing rights and protections for particular activities, including submarine cables, establishing some initial provisions regarding environmental protection, which most of the world's nations have decided are insufficient. That's why there have been negotiations at the UN over the past few years about protecting biodiversity in the marine environment. But this initiative, which was initially really led by the United States, although the United States ironically ended up not signing the convention in 1982 due to some disputes over deep seabed mining issues, but it really reflected an emerging globalization trend, that there was some consensus about international rules for activities in areas that were not governed by any country, weren't within their jurisdictions. And this was a big deal for submarine cables in particular. The preamble of the treaty recognizes the desirability of establishing a legal order for the seas and oceans, which will facilitate international communication. The convention includes extensive provisions addressing state jurisdiction over submarine cables and the protection of submarine cables. And so a lot of my work as the legal advisor for ICPC is working on the implementation and observance of these particular treaty provisions. But globalization didn't just take the form of treaties relating to the oceans and the law of the sea. It also focused on market opening and different kinds of trade. Historically, post-World War II, one of the Bretton Woods institutions that was established in addition to the International Monetary Fund, the World Bank, and the United Nations, was what became the General Agreement on Tariffs and Trade, the GATT, but that was focused only on trade and goods. In the 1990s, the world's trading nations started to look during an additional round of trade treaty negotiations known as the Uruguay Round, to look at trade in things like services and investment and various kinds of services, including telecommunication services, and establishing rules for these kinds of exchanges and market access and investment. And this ultimately resulted in a set of commitments that were agreed in 1997, the Uruguay Round ended in 1994, but discussions in some sectors, including telecommunications, continued for another few years. And this liberalization, it was 69 countries plus the European Union that agreed to make commitments to open their markets for trade and telecommunications services and new investment. And this attracted significant capital and into the sector, particularly for submarine cables, supported new entrepreneurial models for ownership and operation. You didn't have to have effective competitive opportunities if the country on the other end had made commitments to liberalize its market. And companies like Global Crossing were able to build, own, and operate cables on an end-to-end basis without having local partners in order to get into foreign markets. And so this enabled a significant amount of new cable construction. Of course, there was a crash in the early 2000s, but certainly the industry rebounded after that. But this was another aspect of a rules-based approach. There was great excitement about this. My friend Laurie Sherman wrote an article in the Federal Communications Bar Journal about these negotiations. She was a lawyer at the U.S. Trade Representative's office at the time. And when some of the core principles had been agreed, the U.S. government came back to meet with U.S. companies, and representatives of U.S. companies were holding up a sign that said wildly enthusiastic, which is the source of the title for her article. So since that time, obviously the internet has been commercialized substantially. That was really just a nascent thing at the time of negotiation of WTO commitments and basic telecommunications, including submarine cables. But we also had significant technological developments that actually started in the 1980s with fiber optic systems and digital communications, which also enabled encryption as a security technology, as a means of protecting communications from unauthorized surveillance. Governments, of course, have always been very conflicted about encryption. It can protect communications, but it can also deprive them of access to things that they want access to. And the U.S. government, for example, long challenged private sector development of encryption, asserting that it was a violation of U.S. regulations governing and executive orders governing classified information, and that it was violating U.S. export controls. Those challenges ultimately failed, but they were indicative of government concerns about encryption. And then, of course, the focus on globalization came to a screeching halt with the September 11th attacks in the United States. And since that time, security concerns have really supplanted the sort of globalist trade and law of the sea developments, although more so with trade than with law of the sea since that time. These attacks prompted many nations to increase their national security regulation of infrastructure, investment and transactions, and escalate surveillance in order to gain better information about risks and threats to their national interests. The U.S. government created the Department of Homeland Security in 2003, and Team Telecom, which had, it's never quite clear, it depends on who you ask, when that function was really established. But it really became a thing around that time for review of FCC applications for new licenses, including submarine cables, and also for transactions. And since then, this has created substantial regulatory uncertainty and burdens for submarine cable licensing. There was a brief period in the early 2000s when it was possible to obtain a cable landing license from the FCC in 45 days. We don't have that anymore in the United States. It is possible in other countries. Australia manages to conduct both a licensing process and a national security review in 60 days, but not in the U.S. In 2002, the U.S. government blocked on national security grounds the joint acquisition of a then bankrupt Global Crossing by Hutchison Whampoa and ST Telemedia of Singapore. ST Telemedia ultimately made a solo acquisition of Global Crossing, but the current concern with Hutchison was alleged links between Hutchison's controlling owner, Li Ka-shing, and the Chinese government and military. There's a lot of focus on investment in national security reviews and also surveillance during this era. Some of this is not abated. Of course, during the early to mid 2000s, it turned out AT&T had been cooperating with the National Security Agency in a program based in San Francisco to provide copies of Trans-Pacific traffic to the U.S. government. And there were concerns that what AT&T and others were doing actually violated the law. Congress ended up changing the law to grant them an amnesty. That actually predated the disclosures by Edward Snowden. In 2009, New Zealand's intelligence agency was tracking the installation of a submarine cable between Samoa and American Samoa and viewed it as a potential threat to surveillance by the Five Eyes countries in the Pacific, as they found it much easier to conduct surveillance of satellite communications. And the New Zealand government was trading that intelligence for access to the NSA's X key score database of intercepted communications. But it wasn't just the United States or the Five Eyes countries that were reacting during this period. Countries like Brazil were seeking to promote their own independent infrastructure that wouldn't land in the United States, the idea being that it would be less likely to be subject to interception activity. Of course, what we have right now that everyone's talking about, it's on the front page of the paper every day, is the new great power rivalry between the United States and China. And there's an enormous amount of activity by both the U.S. and the Chinese governments with various initiatives. In the English language press, certainly I think the U.S. efforts get a lot more media attention. But the United States, as I think everyone is aware, has been seeking to block the use of Chinese vendors in the U.S. and abroad, encourage its allies to do the same. It has revamped its foreign investment review processes and export controls to try to limit China's ability to obtain particular emerging and sensitive technologies. The United States is also seeking to block or revoke licenses held by Chinese carriers, impose other restrictions on Chinese state-owned companies, and most notably for the submarine cable industry, block direct cables connecting the United States to Hong Kong. China has been vigorously promoting its Belt and Road Initiative and Made in China 2025 plan, and some of this infrastructure includes submarine cable infrastructure. China has also adopted and implemented its national security law, and of course its cybersecurity law as well. And most notably has now applied the national security law in Hong Kong, which has created an enormous amount of political controversy and has really driven the part of the change with U.S. policy. U.S. ally Australia has also intervened against China and Chinese vendors in Pacific Island nations like the Solomon Islands and Papua New Guinea with system procurements. So this, again, is a highly selective overview of some things that we've seen since the mid-19th century, but it's meant to offer some perspective that this sort of cross-border activity that is of such great economic importance and has security and political implications is necessarily a focus of political activity by governments. And so a lot of this is not new. It can take new forms, and certainly it's not just politics, but also technology that can drive how governments behave with respect to submarine cables. And there has always been an intertwining of security issues with competition and protectionism as well. It's difficult to distinguish purely economic considerations from national security or political ones. The industry in many cases has reacted by innovating, particularly with routes. So we've seen new route developments to deal with particular problems, whether it's in, as Elaine mentioned, with Egypt, the Suez Canal, and the Red Sea, and Aqaba, in the Caribbean with Cuba, now as we're also seeing with the South China Sea and decisions to pursue alternative routes through Indonesian archipelagic waters. And so a lot of these political considerations, and this will be a subject of our discussion later on, are not subject to great influence by operators themselves, although governments can be educated about commercial activities and the importance of network resilience and technologies that can improve security. Industry can also educate itself better through those interactions to anticipate and prepare for political impacts on their businesses. So with that, I will turn it back to Elaine.
Thank you very much, Kent. That was terrific. I'm sure there'll be a lot of questions in and around this, even after we get through our panel. I'd like to turn it over now to Mike. Mike, thank you.
Can everyone see that okay? Okay. thank you, Elaine, for your great introduction, and also Kent for that brief but insightful history into the geopolitics surrounding submarine cables. I'm going to delve a little bit deeper into... Sorry, that's where I needed to be. As I was saying, I'm going to delve a little bit deeper into outlining the unprecedented change that's facing our industry. Because while governments have had an influence on our industry for a long time, as Ken has pointed out, there are many things that are in a state of change, and many things recently, which were touched on briefly, are unprecedented. So I'm going to look in terms of network security. And I'll take a brief look at where our networks are vulnerable and what we currently do to address these risks. And then I'll touch on what I think is a potential solution that we as an industry can proactively use to look at addressing the prevailing concerns in this rapidly changing environment. As Kent also mentioned, we are, by the sheer nature of what we do, a truly unique industry. I can't think of any other industry apart from a pipeline that may cross one or two international boundaries. By the nature of our systems, we cross multiple national, international regulatory jurisdictions. These days, our systems are now widely regarded as critical infrastructure, and that's infrastructure that's fundamental to today's digital economy. So we now lie at the intersection of prevailing geopolitics, technology, and all issues associated with data security. Cybersecurity and data privacy is cited as one of the most pressing concerns of the digital age. And I think you just need to look at the recent flight of users from the WhatsApp application to see how important data privacy is to people. However, today, cybersecurity and data protection is increasingly intertwined with politics, trade barriers, competition, and falling trust between nations. And some of the recent events we've seen in our industry, I think, are some of the first signals that profound change is coming to our industry. As we saw earlier, there's a long history of government influence in subsea systems. But not all areas of influence are new, as Kent pointed out, but all areas of interest influence are changing. So the recent event where the PLCN license was rejected by the FCC for the Hong Kong-US connectivity on that system, I think is a clear signal that there'll be no more direct USA-China connectivity. This is unprecedented and has caused the withdrawal of other Trans-Pacific license submissions while investors rethink system design and network configurations. However, traffic still needs to flow between these nations, regardless of the politics and as their economies are closely tied. And if you look at the top four companies, US companies doing business in China, their combined annual revenues exceed 100 billion. So while all of this is going on, the US government is actively revoking Chinese carriers 214 licensing, limiting their ability to operate in the States. In other areas, as both Elaine and Ken have touched on, systems under development seek to avoid disputed areas and complex regulatory regimes. And the South China Sea is obviously one of those. And as ESCO later on will discuss the complex geopolitical aspects associated with the Arctic Connect system. We are also seeing government-backed infrastructure funds coming to the market to support system finance. Now, this goes beyond the traditional ECA or Export Credit Agency support. In 2018, there was an announcement of a US, Australian, and Japan trilateral infrastructure fund that had a clear mandate was to influence the Indo-Pacific region along geopolitical lines. Also, you've seen the Chinese with their Belt and Road Initiative look to develop infrastructure, both terrestrial and subsea. In terms of free market economics, we're seeing severe supply chain restrictions, not just in our sector, but also in other tech sectors. We're also witnessing direct government pressure on system investors to influence decision-making in what would be free market tender processes, not to mention broad statements about free tenders and what is regarded as competitive supplier pricing. In network management, governments are increasingly looking at regulations associated with how systems are operated and managed. And finally, in another area, we're seeing increasing focus on cabotage initiatives, primarily in the region I'm in Southeast Asia, with Malaysia and Indonesia, both invoking cabotage or looking to invoke cabotage restrictions, which, as many of you know, impacts the critical maintenance operations of our networks. So I think we must ask ourselves, things like these cabotage regulations initiated for security purposes or pure economic protectionism, or a bit of both? As Kent certainly delved into, cable security is paramount, as it is critical infrastructure, and that such infrastructure is targeted in times of conflict. And I picked up on the point there that the first deliberate severing of a cable was during the 1898 Spanish-American Civil War. In the interim, headlines have reported state and non-state actors interfering with other cables. And by that, I mean tapping or unwanted intrusion into the data transmission through our cable systems, as Kent termed surveillance. Many nations have laws and regs that cover such actions, detailing the right of government access to data transmission and their license and or security agreements. So in the next slide, we're going to look at the network security in today's terms, in terms of the physical infrastructure, that's both terrestrial and wet plant, and in terms of network management, as any software-driven products associated with things like network management systems are inherently more vulnerable to covert intrusion or hacking. I'll also touch a bit more on maintenance because it's another area that I don't seem to think we have focused on much when we look at terms of security. So the physical infrastructure is probably what most of us are familiar with. As an industry, we have well-developed best practices in system design and engineering to protect systems from external aggression and environmental factors. In some areas, such as here in Singapore, operators also commission AIS-based vessel tracking systems to enhance protection from ship interference. So this is using the AIS system that ships of certain categories are required to use, very similar to flight, the airline industry. Alarms are set for around a cable corridor, and when those alarms are triggered, either contact with a ship can be initiated to warn it off its proximity to cables. This obviously doesn't factor in unwanted intrusion from either state or non-state actors. Actually, in this regard, the routes of subsea systems are widely published. Therefore, actual system locations are readily available, and that can have an increasing impact on network vulnerability when those routes are in the wrong hands. At a network management level, security is much more complex when dealing in the virtual world associated with the network management software. We are seeing some governments becoming more proactive in understanding system operational aspects and establishing detailed regulations and protocols for system management and security. Other governments, however, only provide a high-level framework, which is really open for system operators to interpret. However, the onus is firmly on the network. The onus on network security remains firmly on the operators, with penalties for non-compliance. And if we look to wet plant maintenance, as I suggested before, regulation is relatively light. Article 113 of UNCLOS cites obligations of signatories to report cable outages, with other obligations relating to policing of cable protection. The US government and some other governments is a bit more proactive. In 2016, the FCC put in place reporting systems where network operators are obligated to report cable outages. But when it comes to actual onboard vessel maintenance operations, this is when ships are physically picking up cables from the seabed. There is no government security focus when considering potential for unwanted system intrusion. As far back as 1884, cable security was on the agenda of nations. And again, I'm sort of crossing a bit with what Kent has indicated before. The 1884 Convention for the Protection of Submarine Telegraphic Cables had a primary goal, and that goal was the protection of cables outside of territorial waters. But from a security perspective, Article 113 of UNCLOS only goes so far as it requires signatories to adopt laws to penalize and or punish actors negligently or willfully interfering with cables. But that has been very difficult to enforce. So we do have a patchwork of international laws to address security of cables from physical intervention. It's interesting that during the forming of the UNCLOS, the forming and negotiation of the UNCLOS agreement, intelligence gathering was discussed but explicitly excluded. So I'm sure that all of you are familiar with the ITU, an international body tasked to advocate policy and regulations across the entire ICT ecosystem. However, as you see here, there's a clear omission as to any focus on submarine cables and security aspects. But we aren't alone. The rapid development of digital technologies brings new security challenges and government concerns at national, corporate, and individual connectivity perspectives. If you look at advances of AI and other enabling technologies such as broadband, cloud services, the Internet of Things, and recent advances in 5G, are redefining the concept of connectivity. Governments are adopting a range of measures to protect and address data security concerns across these network platforms. Most, if not all, nations have specialist ministries or departments tasked with detection, resolution, and prevention of cybersecurity concerns. However, I think it's clear, and I think it would be a bit naive to think that all security concerns are driven solely by vulnerabilities in technology alone, but are heavily intertwined with geopolitics, economic protectionism, competition, and or other government interests and agendas. There are a number of areas where a specific subsea industry advocacy group may help to address security concerns associated with our cables. And I know the ICPC has touched on this, but clearly any approach needs to be collaborative and a unified approach, and an approach between governments and industry. So whatever framework is developed, it will need to involve third-party verification, as I'm sure you've all heard the term trust but verify. And by the way, that was a phrase taught to Ronald Reagan by a Russian scholar when he was visiting Russia. After all, this could be the basis for the Clean Networks Initiative that's currently being promoted. However, over decades, the ITU and other international telecom bodies have made great strides in delivering continuity, reliability, and compatibility across telecom networks. But in the subsea sector, we've had a distinct lack of an industry advocacy body that contributes to advancing policy and government regulatory discussions. You've only got to look to the mobile industry, which in 1995 set up the GSMA. That's the Global System for Mobile Communications. This international body has united around 750 operators and 400 companies from across the entire mobile ecosystem. In this time, the GMSA have progressed and formulated what they call as their Network Equipment Security Assurance Scheme, or NESAS. So there is some evidence that such international bodies, where collaboration between industry and government can work. So where do we go now? In my previous slide, I suggested a cohesive advocacy body represented from across the industry tasked to engage at a policy and regulatory level with either international bodies and or directly with respective governments. However, political will is required from both industry and government. And for industry, that means setting aside short-term commercial interests for the benefit of broader industry interests. And I think we as an industry have responsibility to promote discussion and support such initiatives. Likewise, if all nations want to benefit from the expansionary economic rewards of a digital economy, it's in their interest to also engage, as they must also have the political will. Perhaps this widely mooted Clean Networks Initiative we are seeing could be the first opportunity for industry to engage at government levels. Now, regardless of prevailing politics and the political environment, traffic still needs to flow between nations, as economies will never completely decouple. I don't think any one person, company, or country can address the complexity of cybersecurity issues alone. And if this approach is taken, I think it could be destined to fail. So we as an industry have a choice, to be proactive or to do nothing. If the latter, and we continue to ignore the profound changes and unprecedented events taking place recently, we are left with our industry open to a splintering of networks and supply chains with two or more global network topologies driven by competing political interests. And I've been saying this for a few years now, that we are at risk of a bifurcated network, a network based on competing government geopolitical ambitions, economic protectionism, or other agendas. However, these two networks will still have to interconnect, but that interconnection will be in hubs with what I've always termed as a digital Berlin Wall scenario. If direct connectivity is to be restricted between some nations, this will obviously have a direct impact on traffic patterns, which will have broad-reaching impact on system design and cost-effective builds. Interconnection hubs themselves will need to be located in friendly or neutral locations, but I think there'll still be a requirement for some form of transit security protocols. That's transit traffic security protocols. And if we as an industry choose to do nothing, we'll be left with inconsistent regulations, a lack of unified security standards, and increasingly ad hoc intervention by some largely uneducated governments. I do agree with Kent and what Kent summarized. We won't ever influence the underlying geopolitical ambitions of governments, but we do have the opportunity to engage, educate, promote, and potentially influence government intervention in terms of any negative impacts and government responses to our industry concerns. An industry advocacy group is, in my mind, a first initial step. And I think it's time, beyond time, that we start to have this discussion, which I'm pleased to be involved in right now. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Mike. That was a terrific setup for the next part of our panel discussion. We'll resume at 5 minutes after the hour and talk about many of those issues that Mike has just laid out so thoughtfully in his presentation. During the next few minutes, which will be a break, feel free to go away from your computer, but I hope that you'll really keep your computer logged into the session so that you can join us immediately back for the beginning of the questions and answers, and some background also on the Arctic Connect system and geopolitics and that system from ESCO. So we'd now like to turn on, from our sponsor, we have a very short video that will run repeatedly for a few moments during the break about Suboptic 2022 plan for April of next year. And hope to see you back here in just a few minutes. Thank you.
We'll be right back.
We're just about to get started while everybody comes back in. Thank you for your patience. We've got one more panelist, Esko. We're all back now. So thank you again, and especially to both Kent and Mike for those wonderful background presentations. I know you put a lot of work into them, and they really helped to paint a backdrop for our upcoming discussion. As both of you mentioned, I'd like to start this, Andy, with you. You're going to be on the spot first, Andy. You know, we've entitled this panel discussion, The Impact of Geopolitics on Our Industry. Geopolitics is an all-encompassing word. It embraces things like security. It embraces things like economics. It embraces simple politics, whatever that means. And sometimes those pointed out. Andy, in your view, all the stuff that's going on right now between U.S. and China, and I know you're in the heart of it with some of your clients, and you have to keep, you know, all that stuff a little bit private. What really is the essence behind the U.S. government's concern about all of these things between U.S. and China as it relates to cable?
Well, thanks, Elaine.
Is it political? Is it security?
I think you put your finger on really what is the core question, because while the issues raised in terms of U.S.-China tech issues, which apply to equipment, terrestrial, and particularly submarine cable, is couched as security, I think security is only one piece of it, and frankly, not the largest piece. I think the biggest piece is really, you know, economic and political, and, you know, concern about perceived, you know, technological lead, you know, when it comes to 5G. And I think initially the concern arose in the equipment area, you know, particularly in regard to Huawei and ZTE with the HPSI hearings before Congress in 2011. They later morphed into concerns at the Federal Communications Commission to restrict the use of Huawei and ZTE equipment. And I think a lot of it is really rooted in the fact that the U.S. woke up to the fact that we don't have an indigenous telecom network manufacturer. I mean, most of, you know, the Western Electric, Motorola, Nortels of the world have morphed into the European carriers. And I think a large part of it is just to throw sand in the gears and to slow them down. And I think this attitude in terms of Chinese dominance has become somewhat jingoistic and has spread, particularly in the Clean Initiative by Secretary of State Pompeo, you know, away from equipment and into telecom services as well. So I think that's really the problem, that, you know, let's dissect what really, if it's an security issue, we can treat it as a security issue through technology, through better practices, through procedures. But to disguise the security issue in terms of economic nationalism and domestic politics really makes mitigation impossible. And in fact, that's what the U.S. recently said to China Telecom and earlier to China Mobile, that in connection with their 214 licenses, mitigation was not possible. I mean, my personal view is mitigation of national security issues are almost always possible. And, you know, that to me really suggests that the concern on security is really a bit of a Trojan horse, to address, economic nationalism.
I think there are a lot of people like you who believe that it really is a mixture of things, and maybe the economic issues are greater than the security issues. We'll come back in a few minutes to talk more about the security-related specific concerns. I think, though, Ken, from my earlier discussion with you, you may feel that it's not as much economic as security-related concerns. Am I right? How do you see that situation?
So I think it can be a mix of all three. It can be difficult to distinguish the security from the political, from the economic. It depends on who you ask. Andy mentioned Secretary of State Pompeo, who I think has made a lot of highly politicized statements. The Clean Networks Initiative is very much a political initiative. It's not clear where it's going to go, particularly with the Biden administration. But with security issues, I think it's important not just to dismiss that as political or protectionism, even though they can be. My bigger concern is that security can be understood too narrowly by governments. So I think it's worth considering just briefly the U.S. Department of Justice's view about what the issue is with submarine cables. And it really is, as they've articulated it, and I think this view is sincerely held. Other parts of the U.S. government may want to politicize this, use it as part of a nationalist economic agenda. But the view is that the routing and aggregation of U.S. person data on networks through what the U.S. government sees as adversaries and on networks owned by operators that it believes are subject to the jurisdiction of adversary governments could give those adversaries unauthorized access to vast amounts of information that could be used for targeting or other hostile purposes. And this is not limited to China with its national security law or the cybersecurity law. This also comes up with Russia with its SORM law. These laws give governments the right to access a lot of data. I think that this understanding of security is too narrow and is not looking at, as Andy mentioned, the possibility for mitigation as well. First, it assumes that we can distinguish good and bad actors and that bad acts are always going to have a geographic nexus. I don't think that's the case if you talk with people who work on security for a living. Networks are networks. Users ultimately are connected to every other user, and therefore everyone could pose a risk or a threat. And so once something leaves, if you're an operator, your facility, you have your own security policies for what you're doing, but gets beyond your facility, everybody is potentially posing a threat or a risk for you. And you need to behave accordingly to protect your customers' traffic or your own traffic. I think this also fails to account for technological advances in encryption that protect traffic. A lot of these objections that have been filed by the executive branch with the FCC, for example, never once use the word encryption. And I think that's because governments have a very conflicted view of encryption. They recognize that it can offer protection, but they don't like it because it impedes their access to get access to what they want. But I think most fundamentally, it doesn't think more broadly about the need for network resilience. All of this focus on potential bad actors is not looking to promote a really robust mesh network of terrestrial and subsea facilities that are going to make it harder for one bad act to take down big parts of the network. And so I think there's a lot of work to be done. We can circle back with this later about engaging with governments. But I think some of the discussion, we need to take it as security and engage on security, but make clear that the discussion is not considering the key elements.
So are you ready to take this on and talk about this perhaps in the context of your experience in Arctic Connect? But you have to go off mute.
Yeah, I do. I'm sorry, I didn't hear your first words, but I expect that you want me to comment on this and then to speak about Arctic Connect as well.
I do, thank you, yes.
How many minutes do I have? Because I can speak rather long, but maybe you will.
How about shoot for 5 to 10 and see where you get with that? We've okay. got a,
five
a
minutes.
Bit over an hour.
It would be fantastic. May I start with commenting on this security issue, because I think this is, as it has been said, this is nothing new. We have seen this aspect there from the beginning, and time to time it's going down, time to time it's coming up. And I think it's there is a tricky balance between independence and interdependence. And now, not only the US government, but many other governments are, and the European Commission as well, and European Union as well, is looking at how to protect independence, how to guarantee that you have independence to act in all circumstances. And that's why we have seen this kind of change in the mindset. I can see good forces and bad forces, or positive, maybe better to say, positive forces and negative forces. And this protectionism combined with interest to keep control over the networks, that is maybe, or those are maybe those negative forces. They are now limiting our opportunities. But at the same time, we have rather strong forces promoting expansion of global networks and submarine cable networks as well. First one is trade. I remember very well when we had the Cold War position and division between the biggest, two biggest powers of most powerful countries in the world. It was very, very, let's say, strong position between these two. And there were no interaction between these two. But if you look at today's situation between the United States and China, the fact is that never before two most powerful countries in the world have been so much interconnected like the US and China are. And trade is most fundamental in that. So I assume that on the longer term, there has to be certain balance between independence and interdependence because of that factor as well. And secondly, I remember very well the beginning of mobile business. In 1990, I got my first mobile phone. Do you remember how many mobile phone users we had in the world year to 1990, 30 years ago? 10 million. 10 years later, 700 million. And now the figure is it 7 billion or something like that? So almost in practice, all citizens in the world do have, all the people in the world do have access to networks, and most of them do have internet access as well. And that is one factor. And then if you look at scientific communities, I think that interest to collaborate is still there. I will have a good example of that as well. So I'm not optimistic or pessimistic, but I'm personally possibilist. I believe that there is still, even in those circumstances, opportunities to do something and urgently needed to do something. This Arctic Connect initiative is a good example of what we can do. I will show you, probably you can see this through my camera. No, it's, wait for a second, I will take this out. No, it's not working very well. Can you see this now? So it's indicating what kind of global network we do have today, submarine network we have today. And our idea is to create a new route through the polar sea from Japan to Norway and Finland. That is called Arctic Connect. And it's a good example of what kind of geopolitical challenges we are going to face when this type of initiative has been taken. The first factor is that Russia will be on board. You cannot execute this new connection or new route without Russian contribution. It's not using Russian territorial waters, but using Russian continental self. So without Russia's contribution, it cannot be realized. But in the same time, we can see that the benefits of this Arctic Connect will be huge. It's going to be able to increase security of the global networks, and it's going to improve resilience of the system as well. And we can see a huge potential, economic potential with that as well. We have started to work together with Sinia as a company with its partners. We have Japanese partners, Norwegian partners, and Finnish partners. And major Japanese companies are on board as well. So we have started to work with Megafon in Russia, and now we have a concrete plan what to do, how to do, and how to execute this project. And hopefully this will be available not yet 2023, but 2024 is a realistic target for execution of this project. And it's very interesting that actually today we have got first commitment to this project. User commitment. We have a Nordic research network which has committed to use this investment and to also to invest in this project. It's telling that there is a market for this type of initiative. I know that there are challenges. One of the challenges is how to get Russians on board, how to get them to be ready to accept this kind of connection. And then secondly, what kind of technologies you are able to use in these kind of global circumstances, that is going to be a tricky issue as well. But on the longer term, I'm quite confident that we can find a solution which will make it possible. Because on the longer term, we need this kind of investments urgently, and global community cannot operate well without having well-functioning global telecommunication networks. Probably I used that 7 to 8 minutes now. Thank you.
Thank you, Esko. Russ, can I turn to you? You've obviously got a huge international Asia Pacific network right now. And, you know, I think lots of us know it's run into some challenges with the new clean policy. Can you talk a little bit about how this has impacted RTI and how you see all of this impacting flows of communication across the Asia Pacific region? How is the global map going to change over time?
Sure, but just to reinforce the importance of cables, if you look to one cable that went out between Guam and Saipan in 2017, it just really tells a story of the importance across trade, education, communications, and security. When the IT&E cable went out, there was no access to banks on Saipan. There was no access. There was no airport, no emergency services. Probably the most important, there was no Game of Thrones. I think that's when the complaints really started. Having no airport, you have no economy. And then, of course, when people went inside the next day to take out their money, they didn't exist. There was no access to the bank account. So from that, actually, Kent can eloquently talk about the importance of all the regulations that came out of that. But but trade, education, communications, and of course, security. Now, when it comes to our cables, we set out in 2010, 11-ish to use Guam as a hub. You know, we saw that there were some geopolitical issues that were that made Guam more interesting. Cables had been bypassing Guam for some time because of the distance you had to stop in Guam before going to the United States from Asia. And that's why initially Guam was really important. And then Guam got left behind. But we saw Guam is becoming more important because one is geographically perfect. Two is geopolitically neutral, has infrastructure. And three, it has that thing called rule of law. So Guam was critical. And the impacts have been both good and challenging for us. I would say that when I look back at RTI 2012, when we thought there would be some geopolitical issues between China and the United States, boy, were we right on steroids, right? I mean, we thought there would be some challenges, but we didn't know that there would be anything like this. So what's happened since is we have we have a cable from Japan to Guam and from Australia to Guam, and then from Los Angeles to Guam. And it is being used as a hub, not for primary routes from the United States, but for diversity. Now, there is one cable that has gotten delayed and we withdrew the application, and that is the Hong Kong-Guam cable. And the reason we withdrew the application without going into any detail, but just and only speaking on RTI's behalf is because it wasn't productive for us to continue to wait. It was better that we withdrew the application. We didn't quit the cable, and we expect the cable will be built. But it was better for us, given the geopolitical issues between the countries and the turmoil in geopolitics here in the United States, it was better for us to simply withdraw the application, come back and look at it another date with a level head. We've got a very strong consortium partner that also agreed, and so we pulled back. Now, has that limited some revenue opportunities? Of course, right? India and China, the vast majority of traffic was flowing through Hong Kong and Singapore, with Hong Kong reduced and getting further reduced by either the Chinese government or the U.S. government. Traffic only has three ways to flow for about 3 or 4 billion people. India and China, the ASEAN nations, it has to go either through the CMUI cables through Egypt, or it has to come into Hong Kong to Japan and then over to the United States, and or from Singapore to Australia and to the United States. My guess is, and I'm not the statistics expert, but my guess is about 50% of every website search from 2 or 3 billion people around Asia has to go to the US for some database validation before it comes back to Asia. Well, it only goes a few paths. It goes Hong Kong to Japan and over, and or it goes from Singapore to Australia and over. Some of the big Chinese OTTs, in fact, are coming through the eye-to-eye networks from China into Singapore, Singapore on Indigo or ASC, and then over out on Southern Cross. It's a very good route, and that has some traffic stability. The latency isn't great, but very few companies actually truly need that latency. So, but just to put it in a nutshell, it's been both good and bad for us, a delay on revenue because 3 billion people aren't able to get from Hong Kong to Guam to take advantage of the diverse network that we have. But that's okay. That'll happen sooner or later. It has to happen. It always has. The good news is the traffic that comes through Japan and traffic comes through Australia, a large portion of that will actually diversify through Guam for stability and security, and the rest will go directly from Japan to the US or from Australia to the US. I hope that helps.
Yeah. Well, it helps paint a very complicated picture, Russ. I can say that I've been personally pondering some of those questions myself. When I think of the Pacific region, I think of, as you said, some of the northern routes, which are the shortest routes to Asia going through or right by Japan on their way to other parts in Asia, predominantly historically over the last 20 years to Hong Kong, tying into Kent's comments about the WTO. And the new routes, we all know, there's been some recent public news about some cables that are going directly to Singapore through Guam again, to avoid the South China Sea through the Java Sea and around Indonesia. And we all know Singapore has been a major hub as well. So we at DRG think of Asia Pacific as centering on Japan, Hong Kong, and Singapore. And, you know, it's been an interesting evolution of that architecture over many, many years, because, you know, somebody could say, as a matter of fact, I think somebody did say on yesterday's part of the workshop, the Atlantic is similarly route diverse right now with multiple routes in different parts of the ocean. And if we can't connect directly between the US and Hong Kong anymore, we all know that the design goal to meet robust networks is more than just two crossings, right? And, you know, diversity at landings as well as diversity in routes. And so I scratch my head, is Guam going to displace Hong Kong? Is you know, the Philippines and Taiwan are right on the way to Hong Kong. You know, logically, they might be alternatives. And I don't know that any of us knows the answer to that. And the other question that goes through my mind in the global routing context is, who is going to connect directly to Hong Kong? Is Hong Kong still going to connect directly to some of these other cables, countries that have signed up to the clean policies, which the US government is pushing? So I'd like to use that as a long-winded entree to Kent, Andy, Mike, whomever, Esko, if you're familiar with this. What is clean? Whether it's clean network, let's forget about HMN and 5G, but in terms of clean network, clean cable, what does clean mean in our world for cables land, for cables landing in the US and for cables that land in countries that sign up, to clean? Who wants to take that first?
I'm happy to. But Elaine, can I just make one comment, before I get to clean? Because I think you really raised a good point about the Philippines. I mean, you know, here we've seen in the last 4 years, a change in the Philippines. And this is even within the same Trump administration. Initially, the Philippines was looked at, given their president, by the Trump administration as, somewhat skeptical. There were concerns about which way the Philippines were leaning, how predictable they were. And, now, things have warmed up and there seems to be more of a detente between the U.S. and the Philippines. And that's great on one level, but it's particularly, disconcerting, as we all know, in the submarine cable industry, where you have a tremendously long lead time and planning. I mean, you just can't plan networks and plan routes, based on, who's the prime minister and who's in power and how favor they are with one administration or another. I mean, it just would be chaotic. And I think that leads into the clean initiative. This was something that U.S. Secretary of State Pompeo proposed in April of 2020. And it was really a way to, entice, U.S. allies and third world countries to reduce China's influence around the world, and particularly to reduce the influence of Chinese equipment. And basically what it did is, said that anyone entering or exiting U.S. embassies or U.S. diplomatic facilities had to have so-called clean, which is a very subjective word in the eye of the beholder, but how to have clean facilities, both in terms of carriers, terrestrial carriers, submarine carriers, applications, cloud, and applications from third stores. So it really said, if you want to connect to the U.S., you want to connect to U.S. embassies, it's going to be a real problem if you're using non-clean, i.e. Chinese, maybe Russian carriers, submarine carriers, and the like. And a number of European entities, I think ultimately 50 countries, including 27 to 30 NATO countries, signed on to it. What's interesting is that, earlier this morning, Brazil said that it was backing off its earlier representation not to use Huawei equipment, given the change of U.S. administration. So, I mean, I think this just epitomizes the fact that particularly in an area of long-term infrastructure planning, like submarine cables, you know, we have to find a better way, a more technical way, a more transparent way to deal with these very legitimate security issues, as opposed to the politics du jour, because I mean, it's really going to, you know, frustrate financing, you know, in cables. I mean, I spend a lot of my time assisting, you know, submarine cables in terms of obtaining financing and negotiating financing. And the two things that Warren Buffett said that, you know, resonate with me that are essential to investment are optimism and predictability. And if we don't have predictability, I mean, it's going to be very difficult to continue to attract the kind of financing that we need in the submarine cable space.
Yeah, I think Kent has been one of the most vocal people about saying the biggest problem with clean right now, forgive me for paraphrasing Kent, is not the policy in and of itself, but the surprise of the policy being instituted in the middle of many projects being constructed and hundreds of millions of dollars of submarine cable now sitting in the bottom of the Pacific, waiting to be connected and or turned up consistent with current regulatory policies, which changed during the course of construction.
Yeah, Elaine, if I could just elaborate a little bit, I think it's important to distinguish between the Clean Networks Initiative that Andy was describing and what we might describe more colloquially as clean, but it's not part of the State Department's initiative with the security reviews conducted by Team Telecom. That's very much separate. The Clean Cable Initiative, which Secretary Pompeo announced later on, it's not clear exactly where that's going to go, if it's simply ratifying what the U.S. government's already been doing, particularly in working with Australia to encourage Pacific Island nations not to contract with Chinese vendors. But in terms of what is clean, it's still a network. You're still connected to everybody else. So even if you don't have the Chinese equipment landing in your country, if you view that's the problem, it's still in networks elsewhere. And you can have domestic threats and actors in your territory who pose a threat to you. And so I think that this assumption that this is all geographic or by nationality is missing some key security threats and risks. And as I noted before, again, the mitigation discussions just don't reflect all of this as well. To follow up on Andy's other point about the Philippines and about the difficulty of changing course midstream, I think it's a critical issue for the industry, not just for the system developers themselves, but for the whole ecosystem. In each of these current hubs, in Japan, in Hong Kong, and in Singapore, there's a whole ecosystem of other internet service providers and carriers who built infrastructure to meet each other and exchange traffic there. And so that's not going to move or change overnight, even if cables start landing elsewhere in places like the Philippines, because there are a lot of Asian carriers who built their own infrastructure who have no interest or no funding to move. So they're going to stay where they are. We also have regulatory problems. Why are Hong Kong and Singapore in particular have they been such attractive places to land? It's because they're historic trading entrepôts that have had very open entry policies and try to get everybody to come there and do business. And a lot of other places in Asia are not open for business with foreign investment and having clear rules for settling disputes and protecting investment. And so much as the hyperscalers in particular would probably like to have a lot more diversity to support their networks and their data centers, they don't have a lot of good options right now because the regulatory environments are poor in a lot of these other places in Asia where they might want to go.
Everybody's comments open up 10 more questions, but I know Esko had something he wanted to add.
For the first, I think we have to accept the fact that security challenges are there and they are real. But secondly, if you look at traditional traffic, we don't expect that it's going to be 100% secured. We understand that there has to be certain, we have to accept certain level of risks when having traditional traffic. I think in the same way, we have to be able to understand that there is going to be certain amount of risks. And to be honest, it's not the United States only who is worried about cleanness of the system, but actually Chinese vocabulary includes the same kind of aspects. So all are concerned who is having control, and they are worried about that control. How we can mitigate that risk? I think I can see two methods. We have used one in this Arctic Connect case. So we have made two kind of systems. We have a continental system, continental subsystem, which is connecting Japan and Europe. And then we have a subsystem, which is serving Russian markets. That is one method. Another method is that we will expand the network. I believe that submarine systems are the best option anyway. And when we are going to expand that system, the more complicated, more, let's say, extended the system is, the less relevant are these security concerns. I'm believing that when investing in this system, we can in the best way mitigate also the risk of security.
So let me ask you guys, what's the difference between security related concerns on a border crossing network compared to a subsea network that crosses, you know, international waters? From a security perspective, are governments equally worried about border crossing cables? Are they facing similar kind of challenges? Does anybody know? Kent, I think you've been rumored to be a proponent of one of the solutions, potential solutions around the U.S. China conundrum is Canada, China, or Mexico, China. I don't know whether that rumor is true, but would a China to Canada and a border crossing cable between Canada and the U.S. satisfy the U.S. government?
Thanks, Elaine. So I wouldn't say I've been a proponent of it. I wrote an article for Subtel Forum years ago saying, is it time to land in Canada? Because the U.S. regulatory environment was becoming so unfriendly. And in fact, we see systems in development right now that bypass the U.S. that land in Canada. There are similar discussions about going to Mexico. You know, there will be scrutiny if those systems are seen as an indirect way of landing traffic in the U.S. about how it's getting across the border. And there are, at least for new networks being built across the U.S. and Mexican borders, there are complicated rules with the border commissions that the U.S. has established with each of those countries. And so, you know, there could be similar scrutiny. There isn't a discrete license for that sort of terrestrial infrastructure like there is for submarine cables under the Cable Landing License Act. But you know, there's a desire to diversify, to get traffic across the Pacific. And that's going to continue to drive, as I alluded to in my presentation at the outset, alternative routings. If operators are blocked on one route, they start to look for options in other ways.
Yeah.
Well, there are concerns on terrestrial networks. I mean, not so much for the U.S. because, you know, we have relatively friendly relations with, you know, Canada and Mexico. But if you look at terrestrial networks, you know, between, you know, say, you know, the Russia and the Ukraine, Russian, Georgia, Venezuela, some of the, you know, other countries there, clearly China and India. I mean, there are very legitimate concerns on those terrestrial networks, you know, and so, I mean, the concerns aren't unique at all to submarine cables. I mean, the other thing is, if you look at the intrusions you know, particularly some of the state-sponsored intrusions, allegedly Russia, China. I mean, they're not back doors. They're almost always front doors. I mean, they're almost always using the internet, and they're almost always taking advantage of vulnerabilities in existing software. I mean, you know, these aren't sophisticated products. And I think the other thing that, you know, policymakers need to take into account is that just because a company is headquartered in a particular country and doesn't conflate, you know, their values and their aspirations, you know, with that country. I mean, you certainly can say that in the case of U.S. countries, but, you know, for China, you know, companies, I mean, and even the Chinese government's attitude to Chinese companies, they want them to be profitable and make money. They don't want to necessarily, you know, disparage their global reputation by using them as some sort of subterfuge for espionage, largely because they don't even need to do that. So, I mean, that's why I think, as we've been saying, you know, all of us in various forms, you know, we need to really focus on the core security issues and deal with them, you know, and try to separate a lot of the other, you know, nationalistic, xenophobic, economic issues that are getting conflated.
So,
may I say, I'm not expert in these technological aspects, but it's, I have been told, and I strongly believe in that if there is a wet part and dry part in the submarine system, the dry part is much more vulnerable for security risks.
Yeah, I totally believe that myself. I mean, there's still a lot of, you know, interesting press that you can't help but read about subs hanging off of the cables, you know, the same way Ken alluded to with the hunt for Red October or blind man's bluff kind of stuff, right? And whether that's practically possible without being detected and really going on is a matter of hypothesis by any number of experts. But it's, we all know it's got to be far, far simpler if somebody wants to tap into a cable to do it on land than do it underwater, right? So, but what I can't figure out, and I don't know whether anybody here has a view on it, is, you know, what the most obvious thing that's happening across the Pacific right now is a policy that doesn't allow direct Hong Kong or China to US cables, right? And as some of you have alluded, you know, the concerns are not only on the US, there may be concerns on the Chinese end as well. You know, we could generalize broadly. But so if I were to take that thesis and say, okay, we can still build 10 cables to Japan and 5 cables to Singapore and maybe even 2 to Taiwan and 2 to the Philippines, and they can then all reach into Hong Kong. From a security standpoint, can somebody please do their best to explain to all of our audience, what does that transit point do to improve the security of the signal as the government that's making that regulation perceives it? What benefit do they think a transit point provides relative to the risk?
Let me have a go at that, Elaine. I won't be able to get into the detailed technologies around security, but when you're talking these sort of interconnection hubs or these transit points, my understanding, and perhaps Kent or someone who's better in the know, is that when the licenses on PLCN were given to connectivity to Taiwan and the Philippines, there was some restrictions around onward connectivity to Hong Kong. But true or not, any interconnection hub like that is going to have some sort of security protocols because we live in this hyper-connected world. So even if we do go down this clean initiative, which you know, to me just sounds like, okay, that's an American sort of led thing, and we do have two network topologies, they're still going to have to meet somewhere. And what security protocols are put in those interconnection hubs, you know, that's well beyond my pay grade. But there's going to have to be something, because I don't see how physically the world can benefit from this sort of, you know, digital transformation and the digital economy if we just don't connect anymore, even through a bifurcated internet.
I think the concern is ultimately about the hub and what the U.S. government is doing vis-a-vis Hong Kong is it wants to displace the Hong Kong hub. I think industry has its own reasons for starting to hesitate with Hong Kong, given what the Chinese government is doing, particularly with the national security law. And so they may be doing for commercial reasons what the U.S. government wants anyway. But merely having an intermediate transit point by itself, it's not clear to me what security benefits there are from that. But I think the objective, as I understand it, and as the U.S. government has stated in its filings about these systems, is really to try to encourage alternative hubs and diminish the Hong Kong hub, so that there isn't traffic aggregation in Hong Kong.
Which is a combination of an economic and a security issue. You guys don't all have to mute your phone, your mic, because I'm going to interrupt you as much as you can interrupt everybody else. But to me, in essence, Kent, that says it's economic and security related. Esko?
Yeah, I think it's like we discussed in the beginning, all these dimensions, security dimension, trade, economic dimension, even this, let's say, political aspect, all are integrated into one. And I don't want to say that we have to neglect something, but we have to be able to balance these. And I'm optimistic or possibilist. I believe that at the end of the day, Chinese, Russians, European Union decision makers, Americans have to understand that even when we want to be independent, certain amount of interdependence is urgently needed in order to get business going. Air traffic is a good example of that as well. In spite of all these geopolitical conflicts, we are flying, hopefully in the future as well. We have been flying from country to another. Restrictions are rather limited. And that's,
yeah. So if you want to go from A to B and you're not allowed to fly to B, you go A, C, B, and you get there, you know, going through an intermediate hub, right? I mean, it's the same kind of thing. And I think it gets, you know, a little bit to what Kent said about, you know, the threats are as much within as they are from outside. And it gets to some of what Mike said that, you know, we can't really not communicate. And the way the internet works, eventually the routing finds a way around the world to get the signals where they really want to be. So, you know, there have been a lot of suggestions about a so-called splinternet, really the development of two different global internets, one by the US allies and one by the Chinese allies, which to me just boggles my mind. I can't imagine it because, like you have said, eventually people have to talk to each other and they will talk to each other, and the economies are collectively interdependent. And I don't figure how this is all going to work.
Elaine, it could even get worse than that, because, I mean, if you go back to the Cold War analogy, I mean, you could have the First World, the Second World, and the Third World. I mean, you know, you can have non-aligned nations who would want their own internet, their own network. You might have the EU, therefore, that would want its own network. So, I mean, we're really splintering and separating, you know, a very successful global telecom network, which actually, in my mind, you know, leads to more commerce and more grounds for peace. I mean, I think the way to do it is frankly, you know, the way the Europeans were doing it for ZTE and Huawei equipment, you know, the labs they had in the UK in Cambridge and the EU lab in Brussels, where the vendors paid for the government, for government employees to test equipment for vulnerabilities. I mean, you can do that. You can have mitigation agreements. But to me, you know, the most, you know, disheartening thing is when governments say, you know, there's no possibility for mitigation. There's no possibility for trust. I mean, that just leads to, you know, what Mike was talking about very, you know, articulately in his presentation, you know, about a, you know, bifurcation, a separation of networks. It's like going back to the 19th century when countries were using different gauge railroad, you know, track in order to, you know, keep themselves separate, you know, which backfired on the Russians, you know, when they tried to invade, you know, during World War One, and, you know, their trains, you know, disabled as soon as they hit the border. So, I mean, you know, connectivity standards transparency are really, I think, the main ingredients to consider here.
Yeah, well, I'm sorry.
No, I was just going to add that, we're talking about some very important issues, and all these are integral to having a very safe internet, but we also have very few cables being built by a diverse group of companies or a diverse group of industries. Incumbents aren't building anymore. If you looked in Asia Pacific, across the Pacific in the last 5 years, since 2017, there's probably been 4, maybe 5 cables built. RTI's been 3 of those 5. And the rest that are being started, maybe 15 or 16, are being started and run by 2 companies. So, you know, it's one thing to talk about alternative hubs and all this great trading and exchanging of traffic and how it maneuvers around. But, you know, we also have to take a look at the types and diverse players. If they're not there, you know, the freedoms go away. Yeah, there needs to be sort of a more collective group of entities that help build these cables. I don't have all the answers, of course, right? I have very few of those answers, but I think we also have to look at who's building cables and why and what types of controls.
That's an excellent, excellent point, Russ. I mean, you're really saying, and we've all observed, there's a narrowing of the number of people who are capable with the amount of money that it requires these days of investing in cable. And in fact, you know, one of the questions that I had around this whole clean is it the equipment supplier? We know it's partly that. Is it the cable owner, you know, a co-build partner or whatever? And the sense is it's partly that as well. And we all clearly know it's also where the cable connects. So there's, in my mind, when I try and simplify it because it's so complicated, 3 elements: ownership, supply, and connectivity. And in fact, if we perpetuate this policy that seems to be taking root or being pushed, it's going to further narrow the investment community in cables and reroute the cable map. So I'm not quite sure where it all leads. And I think several of you have inched your way forward into the discussion about where does this take us and what is our responsibility to try and influence this direction as we move forward. And, you know, nobody likes to say, well, I take it back. I see ads all over the internet today in the past several weeks that Facebook says, you know, we need more reform of the internet. And that's obviously not submarine cable specific, but it's rare for any big company to say, I want more regulation. But do we as an industry need broader regulation from some international body? Or do we want to shy away from that totally? Is that one of the few options for helping to solve this conundrum we find ourselves collectively facing? I'd love, Esko, for you to comment on that one.
Yeah, I think in the midst of geopolitical tensions inside different governments, those people who have control over security issues will have upper hand. It's typical, it happens like that. And those security people do not have very good understanding of economics and economic policy interests. Their view is rather narrow everywhere in the world. And I think our interest is to try to communicate with the governments that yes, security issues are critical, important, but you have to understand that there are some other very critical interests as well. And you have to combine all these together. I think that must be part of our communication. Secondly, I think everything is based on trust, and the level of trust is very low. If you can do something to increase the level of trust, that will be good. And thirdly, I think certain amount of regulation is needed. If you can get some international common understanding how to regulate this system, I think it will be good. GSM standard in the telecom or mobile phone business is a good example how good standard is able to promote business in a massive way. But in these circumstances, it's not a very easy task, to be honest.
Well, those of us as lawyers and engineers aren't very good at building trust. Can I say that? But maybe we can work to educate and inform and partner. Who has some good ideas on how we work more with governments to try and help them understand the other sides of the equation, like ESCO, you know, talked about, besides the imperative of keeping everybody secure. Any ideas, thoughts to share on that one? How can we help?
Elaine, if I'll just take lead on that and then turn it over to Kent, because I touched upon it in my presentation, you know, if we have some sort of industry advocacy group to promote this discussion with governments, either or with the ITU or bring it into the ITU. The reason why I wanted Kent to follow up is because I know the ICPC is doing this at a very sort of tacit level or tacitly at the moment. But I also think that any advocacy group that maybe looks at unified network security standards for these interconnection hubs, some sort of joint government industry evaluation or verification. Andy touched on that because, you know, that has been done before. Huawei, for example, had a cybersecurity evaluation center jointly run with the UK government for a long time, which seemed to be quite successful until potentially politics took over. So that has been done before. And I think there are other areas in the world that have that. So, you know, I think there is some sort of movement within ICPC. Kent can speak better to that, but I don't think ICPC is probably the right body to take this to the level and to the detail that's required. I think it needs a broader input from the industry, and I think it does need some security experts.
Just to follow up on Mike's comments, ICPC's focus is on cable protection, and ICPC has endorsed the idea that cable security is a cable protection issue. And ICPC's cable security working group is focused on these issues, but it's focused on things that are unique to submarine cables. Much of what we're talking about here with cybersecurity and risks to data are common to all electronic communications networks. They are not unique to submarine cables at all. The submarine cable security issues that are unique relate to shore end facilities and protection of beach manholes and front hull and cable landing stations. There are questions about the extent to which cables should be marked on nautical charts. They have to be in shallow water areas so that commercial vessel operators and commercial fishermen know where the cables are. You can't hide cables in those areas. You're asking for trouble if you try to. You know, there are questions in the deep ocean whether or not cables should be charted with exact geographic precision. And that's where a lot of the speculation about risks from specialized Russian vessels and submarines comes from. But you know, I think that on the general cybersecurity risks, that work is being done. There are extensive standards and testing bodies and other organizations, whether it's NIST standards in the United States, the International Organization for Standardization, ISO, or others that address cybersecurity and information security risks. So that is being addressed. In terms of more general industry engagement, in talking about the importance of cables and other things, Mike is right. A lot of that is not within ICPC's mission. The submarine cable industry does not have the equivalent of GSMA, which the mobile industry has, in advocating to governments, in part because submarine cables are not a standalone business for most of the operators. They're a cost center. They're not their own thing. And they've typically been handled in different ways as just a discrete business unit within other enterprises, as opposed to mobile operators, where mobile is the thing that they do, and they have a big, powerful industry organization. Having a big global industry body, I'm not sure is going to be very well received by particular governments. So I think that's something that operators need to think about, that they may need to engage more locally or nationally to address some of the particular sensitivities. And it's a complicated ecosystem. Even looking at the United States, a lot of the cables that land in the United States are owned by foreign investors who are not keen to go and call themselves out as foreigners engaging with the U.S. Congress or with U.S. regulators or policymakers. And so there's certainly a need for better understanding and education, but I can certainly see why there's been a hesitation in doing some of that and why the resources are not there.
Well, but do you think that somehow we ought, well, I'm sorry, Andy, did you want to say something?
No, I just wanted to say, I mean, just to piggyback on Ken's comments, I mean, I think the mechanics and are there to, you know, enhance and develop standards. I mean, I think it's really a question of, is there the global will to do that, particularly among major countries? And I think tomorrow is a good inflection point, being inauguration day for a new administration and one that, you know, proclaims to be science and technology based and transparent. And, you know, hopefully that could be the beginning of a dialogue. I think part of the issue is that there was scapegoating and demonizing, you know, among and between countries that just exacerbated this problem. And I think if we can look at this, you know, simply between the prism of a security issue, you know, then we can decide how surgical and how narrow we need to be. And, you know, there are standards. I mean, as Mike pointed out, I worked very closely with the Huawei labs in Cambridge and with the EU labs, you know, in Brussels, you know, looking for the vulnerabilities in equipment. And that's something that the, you know, the equipment vendors pay for, but the testing is done entirely by government employees who are at arm's length, you know, from the providers. You can do that. You can build on some of the LOAs, network security agreements from the US, and impose those globally in terms of access to information. You know, one group that's doing a lot here, Elaine, is the Internet Governance Project out of Georgia Tech. You know, they've been very active. They just filed comments at the FCC and the China Telecom proceeding. And I think global groups like that, you know, have a lot of influence, you know, just because of their global nature and their impartiality. But I really think, you know, we need to narrow down and identify exactly what those security issues are and tackle them. And we have the ways and means, I believe, to do that.
Yeah, well, so.
Hey, Elaine, can I add one more thing? So in the late, so mid-80s, the former CEO of MCI was a guy by the name of Bill McGowan. He had a great saying. Communications is our business, not our practice. And so, you know, I found that very interesting comment, and I bring it up because, you know, when I've met with various different governments, and including the U.S. government, and the meetings are very, you know, they're about it once a year, once every 2 years, and even though I know nothing about the experts like Andy and Kent, I just think that increased communication with other aspects outside of security and all the failings, all the potential problems, there are other benefits that optimists perhaps like me might be able to help explain to, you know, our own policymakers. And if we can increase communications, you know, and I'm not trying to be too idealistic here, but maybe increase those communications between people that are in this industry and have some real expertise and, you know, and partnered up with, you know, great mentors like Kent and others who have helped me along the way, and including DRG, then I think it becomes more of a collaborative effort. It's understood governments have to protect their citizens. We all get that, right? We all have to abide by the rules of the government, of all the governments where we build these cables. But I think it starts with more effective communications within our own governments. Sorry to be so idealistic. It is early in the morning.
Yeah, I appreciate the idealism and the optimism, Russ. So what I was going to say was that I can't imagine, quite honestly, that those of us sitting on this panel and all of the folks that we work with on a regular basis in the submarine cable industry have the wherewithal, despite the efforts of so many more people than those that I just mentioned, to change whatever the conundrum is with the US and Chinese equipment providers. I can't imagine us being the right people to address that issue. I'm sorry for those of you on the call who have interest in that. I think we have to leave that to the people who are responsible for managing that equipment related issue. And I think as an submarine cable industry, thinking about the global network and the supply of submarine cables themselves. That's a narrower set of challenges. And to your point, Russ, sharing information, communicating with the policymakers more than we do right now might be the first next step to try and gain their understanding of the balance of the equation relative to the security risks. But I don't think we collectively have a strategy on how to do that, nor, as Kent alluded to, a will yet. And is everything that's going on now going to create that will? And if we were going to do that, Kent, you said that's not the purview of ICPC. It's not, strictly speaking, the purview of Suboptic either, right? Suboptic is trying to do more, as I alluded to in my opening comments, but it's not part of its divine charter. One of those bodies could expand it. The two bodies could cooperate together. There could be another association. Somebody rescue me while I cough and take this question further. How should we approach this? How do we get something moving to effect a change? Esko, use your brilliance now.
No, I actually tried to answer that question already earlier. I think it's important to explain that communication systems do play extremely important role in economies and national, let's say, policies as well. In order to get economies to grow, you need these global networks, and it's a common interest to take efforts to get this system working in a proper way. It's not going to work in a brilliant way. It's mission impossible. There are weaknesses, there are certain amount of vulnerabilities, but we have to be able to mitigate that those risks as much as we can. I don't know, maybe I'm a bit optimistic now, but I assume that the next administration in the US starting tomorrow, I don't expect that things are going to change in a dramatic way, but we are going to return back to a bit more normal. And I mean predictability. It's important to have predictability. And secondly, it's very important to have business-like communication also between governments. And I don't expect that relations between the United States and China are going to be changed overnight, or tensions with Russia will disappear. They will stay. But I assume that we will have some kind of dialogue anyway. We had, even during the Cold War, we had certain level of dialogue, and we were able to create certain kind of communication methods during that period of time, in spite of the fact that there were no interdependence, almost no interdependence at all. Today we have a lot of interdependence, and because of that, I think it's easier to explain why these systems are so critical, and we have to be able to take care of those. And then finally, when looking at China and even Russia, both have been mentioned several times in this context, who is dependent on who? How much China is dependent on the US? If you look at the Chinese exports and Chinese manufacturing, it's completely dependent on the American market. And quite often when we are speaking about Russia here in Europe, we have the feeling that we are dependent on Russian oil and gas and materials. In a way, yes, but not completely, because if that export of oil and gas from Russia to Europe will be stopped overnight, who is going to suffer? Europeans on the longer term, maybe, but not immediately. But for Russia, it means that 50% of its revenues are starting to, or disappearing immediately. So I think we have to be able to understand that actually behind this scene, there are positive forces as well. They are not that much visible in the midst of these geopolitical tensions, but they are there.
I mean, this seems for, G7, for OECD, for the major economies of the world to agree to this. I mean, it's not just a U.S., China, or Russia issue. I mean, it's impacting a lot of other countries, particularly, EU countries that, want to maintain good relationship in both camps and, want, lower competition prices and want greater connectivity. And I mean, I think, if the U.S. and China can't initiate a bilateral dialogue, or if one country can't take the lead on it, I think it's really, up to some of the other leading, developed economies, to push the issue. I mean, as I was saying earlier, just this morning, Brazil noting the change in administration backed away from the, the clear, program. So you're going to have a lot of countries moving back and forth and, trying to get a consensus for global standards. It really is in everybody's best interest.
Yeah. So we've got about 15 minutes left, and I think we're going to come back and give you all a chance to say what specific message you'd like to give to governments around the globe if they happen to pick up on this on YouTube afterwards, or what you'd like us to see us as an industry to do. But we do have a small number of questions that have come in from the audience. I haven't read them all yet, but the first one that I read was quite interesting. The question comes from Julian Rawl, who many of us know. And it says, hi, Mike. Mike, you're now on the spot. It came in during your presentation, but I think the question really applies to everybody. I agree with your general recommendation, but clean networks is being imposed on us, and therefore it is late in this game to be proactive. We need to get ahead of the curve. Julian, that's not the question I read before. The question I read before that came in during Mike's comments was something to do with, is the clean policy which discourages direct cables between China and the US, in fact, driving the increased trend for the US to become less dominant in the global network landscape? In other words, all of us in the industry know that the US has been the hub, the central point of many, many cables, and everybody wants to get to the content in the US. In the telegeography presentation yesterday talked about how that's changing slowly over time with, the global network architecture evolving and data centers around the globe. And Julian, I thought your question really was, is the US policy going to push the US to become less central? Does anybody have a comment on that question? I thought it was quite interesting.
I do have a comment, Elaine, and thanks, Julian, for the question. I think the U.S. government has long taken submarine cable connectivity for granted. It is not a policy priority for the U.S. government in the way that it is for a country like Australia, which has a very well-defined policy and approach to ensure robust connectivity with the rest of the world. And I think that this is reflected in many ways in terms of the increasing burdens with regulation, which the FCC and others keep piling on submarine cables, almost thoughtlessly, and with regulatory uncertainty, changing course mid-project is very challenging when you're building system long-term fixed infrastructure in the ocean. The United States could, as I wrote about years ago in my Is It Time to Land in Canada piece, could find itself suffering ultimately because nobody's been thinking strategically about the benefits of having great submarine cable connectivity. And we also have a lot of additional complexities in the U.S. because of the way we permit systems with state and local governments who influence where cables get built, which decreases their resilience. But we've long had a U.S.-centric internet that we've taken for granted, submarine cable infrastructure that we take for granted, and that's not necessarily always going to be there unless we have a U.S. government that is thinking thoughtfully about the benefits of those activities focused on the United States for content industries and all the other industries that depend on that connectivity, not least of all financial services. And so I think that part of, you know, in thinking about how to engage with governments, there's a need for some new approaches to policymaking and thinking about these issues, whether that's adopting laws or creating functions within existing institutions to think about these issues. We really don't have that in the U.S. right now.
Esco.
When you asked about the U.S., I returned back to 1978. And in the 1970s, the U.S. faced a lot of both political and economic problems, and there was a discussion about the future of the U.S. dominance in the world, and the Soviet Union was still rather powerful, but thanks to oil revenues it has got, and China was no one was able to expect that China is going to have that kind of future. But 1978, Deng Xiaoping decided that in order to get China to grow and China to survive, even they have to open to international collaboration, and they have to accept that technologies will be decisive for the future. And the Soviets decided to stay with their own rather isolation-based policy. They wanted to rely on their own system, their own technologies. They didn't want to work together with others. And within 10, 15 years, you were able to see radical change. China growing, getting forward, and the Soviet system dissolving.
And reinforcing your dependence, interdependence, independence whole
Exactly. And that's why I'm quite confident that if countries are going to isolate themselves and they are trying to create these kind of clean environments, if it's any country, even the biggest countries in the world, on the longer term, it's not going to work. Better to have common rules.
That's kind of the conundrum of all of this, right? We're in the business of connecting people to keep them working together. And what's being put up is blocking.
Right.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, even Adam Smith 200 years ago said that trade protection hurts the country that imposes it. I mean, go back to 1978, as Esco did. I think it's an important inflection point. You know, at that point, the U.S. put quotas on memory chips, you know, in terms of concerns about Japanese dominance. And all it did is it hurt the U.S. computer industry. You know, the same thing in the late 70s, the U.S. had steel quotas, you know, that forced U.S. Auto manufacturers, you know, to charge more for their cars and, you know, ended up becoming even less competitive, you know, with Japan. So a lot of these, you know, as we saw going back to Smoot-Hawley in the 1930s, I mean, a lot of these protectionism efforts, you know, even though they may be based initially on, you know, well-intended trade and economic issues, often backfire, but particularly in an area of global connectivity like submarine cables. So, yeah, that's why I really think we need to get beyond, you know, the economic jingoism here and really laser focus on what the real security issues are and find ways to solve them.
Anybody else like to add anything before we wrap up with closing comments? This is your last chance. No? Okay, we've just got a few minutes left, so I'd like to go around the table and give you each an opportunity to answer one of two questions. One, you could choose, or you could answer both. What would you like us as an industry to do to influence a constructive outcome of today's situation? Or what specific recommendations do you have for government policymakers that you think would help collectively balance the needs of both governments and our industry? Mike, are you willing to be first in that?
Look, I'll have a shot at the first. Obviously, I was advocating some sort of advocacy group. I appreciate the other panelists' comments that, first of all, there has to be a will, both within the industry and certainly on the government side. And let's just say that, this clean network initiative still continues and we do end up with a bifurcated internet. At least if we start at a basic level of looking at those interconnection hubs, whether it be the Philippines or Canada or wherever else, and find some security standards for that interconnection, we'll still have a bifurcated internet. But I think we should be able to find some sort of security protocols and standards, either through some sort of government evaluation verification or third-party evaluation verification of those security protocols. So at least that we get some standards around interconnection and interoperability policies. I mean, that's a start, taking on the whole thing, as we talked before, we're not going to change the basic fundamental politics and agendas of governments. So maybe you start to take a smaller bite out of the big jigsaw puzzle.
Okay, thank you. Andy, would you go next, please?
Sure. I mean, I think Mike raises some really good points. I mean, I think what you're doing, Elaine, what this panel is doing is a really good start. But we need other governments, to speak up. We need other governments to encourage U.S. and China in particular to sit down and try to have a dialogue on these issues. Who are some of the key players? I mean, the banks play a huge role in terms of financing, these submarine cables. I mean, they can be very influential. The carriers can be influential. I know the hyperscalers are a bit out of favor today, but, they still carry, a big stick. They can still be influential. But I think it's also the industries that are going to be, negatively impacted. I mean, the Qualcomms, Intels of the world, who can see their market share disappear, if we continue to, adopt these protectionism policies. So, I mean, I think, what we can do as submarine cable industry is light the spark and encourage a number of other, sectors of the economy where we intersect with to pick up on it and to, bring their own, significant influence and pressure on policymakers. But, what you've done this morning is an excellent start.
Thank you. The value of it is really in all of you. Russ, how about you next?
Well, as I see it, there's a great quote, only the educated are free, right? And so I think educating the governments, I talked about earlier, increased communication, that can only help. This industry is one of the few industries, it won't work unless we're interdependent. When you land a cable between here and China, you have to have a Chinese partner, and there has to be a US partner, and there has to be some sort of rules of engagement in between. It has to be interdependence. So the only way to call it force, the only way to force that interdependence is through education, and only the educated are free. That's actually Epictetus. That's about 3,000 years ago, I think. But I think it starts with that. Again, I think you have to start with the basics, and you have to crawl before you walk, and you have to walk before you run. But I would say increased education by the right people that focus on the interdependence that these cables have to have between different countries.
Thank you, Russ.
Does that? I don't.
Yeah, thank you, Russ. Kent, you're next to last.
Thanks, Elaine. I suggest that submarine cable operators and other parts of the industry, suppliers, customers, survey companies, consultants, work to define these issues more broadly about as security and resilience. And to make sure that in engaging with governments, which they need to do, whether it's as groups or individually as companies, to make sure that they have the right audience at the table or involved, and work with governments to make sure that the policy environment includes the right people. My concern continues to be that this focus on security and security reviews is too narrow and too prosecutorial in nature. And it ends up missing key security issues, and it rules out from the outset certain kinds of resolutions that should be workable. My other cautionary note would be careful what you wish for in terms of new regulation and new institutions. This industry has benefited enormously from a lot of freedom and flexibility over time. And it has particular rights and freedoms that it can make use of under the Law of the Sea Convention, and other informal understandings and flexibility that it's been able to use to create these amazing networks. And so, while I think there's work to be done with engagement, I don't think we're ever going to get an agreement on a super regulator at the international level, nor do I think that bodies like the ITU are equipped to be that, and some governments would oppose it. But I'm not sure that having that sort of monolithic approach would ultimately be beneficial to the industry. I think more than anything else, we need an environment with regulatory certainty that is really taking account of what's actually going on as a factual matter, and take it from there.
Words to the wise. Okay, Esko, we're going to leave it to you to wrap up.
Okay, thank you. My two messages are, for the first, for the U.S. and European decision makers, I think we are the core of a rule-based world. And we have to start using this power in a more efficient way from now on. And if we can succeed in that, I think it helps to get the right kind of regulatory environment globally to support submarine systems and creation of better network in the future. In spite of the fact that we need China, Russia, and others on board in a way or another, but the core is in the future as well, Europe and the US. And secondly, answer to your first question is that what kind of contribution we can do. I hope that we can get this Arctic Connect to be constructed, because it's a good example that you can do things even in this complex world and this world with tensions. And I'm optimistic that we can do that. And when it is finalized 2023 or 24, I think it's a good example for others as well.
I think we've had a good set of optimists and a good set of ideas exchanged today. And I'm really, really appreciative of all of you who put so much forethought into sharing some interesting ideas with us. The challenge will be to capitalize on them as we move forward. So I'd like to wrap up with thanks to PTC, thanks to Suboptic, and especially thank you to all of our speakers today. It was really a very intriguing discussion. Have a great day, everybody.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Elaine.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Mahalo to Suboptic for another intriguing submarine cable workshop. Sessions will begin again at 11 a.m. Hawaii time, 4 p.m. Eastern time. In the meantime, mingle with conference attendees, visit the exhibit booths in the PTC Hub or one of the Coral Networking Lounges. Enjoy and have fun. Mahalo to Suboptic for another intriguing